What's that film that you love?
What film?
The one about the fucking hairdresser, the space hairdresser and the cowboy. The guy's, he's got a tinfoil pal in a petal bin. His father's a robot and he's fucking fucked his sister. Lego. They're all made of fucking Lego.
Star Wars.
That's the one, right. It's like that, okay. You're gonna fucking kill all the bad guys. And you'll be able to blow up the big...
The Death Star
yeah. thing.
Yes.
Then you can go and live happily ever after on the planet of the teddy bears.
There he walks.
It's a fantastic analogy. Well done.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I present to you Red Spotlight Entertainment.
Two lovely cohorts. One, Mr. Alexis Soto, how are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you today?
That's lovely, Peter Martinez. And then we have Alexis Soto with us in the flesh. How are you today, Alexis Soto?
I am doing great. And I'm sure Peter is doing wonderful as well, seeing as he has a big smile on his face. So.
Nice yeah. restraint, buddy.
always great with you.
Always against the current market.
Alright. So uncivilized. Anyway, today, what a crap hit the interwebs. And
these past 3 days combined, a lot of good things happened. All because of what's happening right now.
Yeah. Star Wars Celebration hit. It's going on in Florida right now. The place where... I was going to make a political joke, but we're not going to go there.
Better not go there. So, Star Wars Celebration.
Star Wars Celebration. We had the reveal of the Last Jedi trailer. We have some information on Star Wars Rebels. Star Wars Land. And then also, of course, the tribute to the great, late great Carrie Fisher. And, so without further ado, here's Red Spotlight number 48, Star Wars Nothing But.
Years ago, you served my father in the Clone Wars.
Well, now, he begs you to help him in his struggle against the Empire.
I regret that I am unable to present my father's request to you in person.
But my ship has fallen under attack, and I'm afraid my mission to bring you to Alderaan has failed.
I have placed information vital to the survival of the Rebellion into the memory systems of this R2 unit. My father won't know how to retrieve it.
You must see this droid safely delivered to him on Alderaan.
This is our most desperate hour.
Help me. Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen. So, let's not diddle-daddle here. Star Wars The Last Jedi, guys.
Okay, so the trailer was...
I want to know what you think, Peter.
Why me?
Because I remember we were on Messenger, and you said that you had fears for this movie. Tell me what those fears were.
It was a good trailer. I really like the director.
Yeah.
Ryan Johnson. I always forget his name.
Because he knows names. He knows right. names, everybody.
He prides himself in names. I love Ryan Johnson. I love Looper and a couple of others earlier films. I think it looks great. It looks beautiful. But all in all, it was a pretty standard trailer. Mm-hmm. The thing that really set it and got me excited was the last part.
The bomb that was dropped.
With Luke saying, you know, it's time for the Jedi to end. And then the Star Wars music, but in a very, like, almost horror fashion, you know. And I guess I really love the fact that we don't know, and there's a lot of different ways it could go. With, you know, Luke, you know, where is he? Why is he feeling that way? Rey, where does she come from? Where will she end up? The same thing with Kylo Ren. Because, you know, I like that.
He's maskless.
He's maskless, but again, you know, he's not just bad guy, you know. especially in the first one, they made it very clear he's struggling, the same with Rey, same yeah. with Luke. So my biggest fear is that that promise made by that little ending words spoken by Luke don't really go anywhere. That it turns out to be very standard. Rey is the good guy, and, you know, Kylo Ren is the bad guy. And then Luke, you know, at the very beginning, he's like, oh, shucks, I don't feel like this anymore. But then Rey's like, come on. And then he's like, all right. And then, you know, he's her mentor, and then she kills him and saves the galaxy. I don't want that same standard crap, you know, because they have a really opportunity to, you know, really deliver something new and interesting, not just for the Star Wars universe, but just as a, you know,
as a
summer film, you know. It could be really
great. You mean a Christmas film.
It's a Christmas present.
That's true.
It feels like a summer movie.
Yeah, it's technically a summer
movie.
It
said there's Christmas in the actual trailer, which yeah. is, if you know, you can believe actually.
That. That's what they do with every Star Wars trailer now. But yeah, that's my only real fear with that, is that it's standard. Especially since they're promising something non-standard.
Mr. Soto?
I think that is perhaps the big bombshell of the entire convention this weekend, is that last line of dialogue when he said, I know one thing, the Jedi need to end. And that is rather substantial for many reasons as far as the future of this franchise, especially when we get to Episode 9, and also the future installments of the saga films or the Skywalkers. And it's just, we have to appreciate the moment. But what that actually means is, I understand the fears that Peter is telegraphing here about this being a tease.
Yeah.
This was a teaser trailer.
Yeah.
But
that's
also
the name.
Yeah. I also do think it would be kind of a mistake, though, if that's what it was. I think whatever it is, the scenario that you pointed out, that everything ends happily ever after, that there's a clear good guy and a clear bad guy, for whatever reason, that does not strike me as Rian Johnson's style. And everything in this trailer kind of went against that. Because I got a different feel in this trailer than what I got from previous Star Wars films. Even from Rogue One, this seems darker than that film.
Because the key component that you have taking in from the trailer is when Rey does say, when Luke asks her, what do you see? The light side, the dark side, and she says, balance. And I have a feeling that what you're going to get with this movie is that you're really going to get the true sense of that term balance.
Really?
Like, not good, not bad, but just somewhere in between. Kind of like what Star Wars Rebels character Ahsoka Tano, you know, is striving to do. You know, she's not entirely good, she's not entirely bad, but she's somewhere in between that.
Well, I guess for me, these past two Disney Star Wars films, I've liked both of them a lot, but none of them have really pushed past the comfort zone.
Okay.
Rogue One definitely did it. Rogue One did somewhat. It was little baby steps. But I really just want them to just full-blown just...
Break the formula.
Break out of that, the Star Wars box.
See, I got that from this trailer.
This could be it.
And like you said, talking about something beyond the Sith and the Jedi, that's cool, that's interesting. And then, because it's something that they really touched on in the prequels, and of course, ever since then, they've kind of tried to, you know...
Stay away from that
stuff.
Stay away
from it, is the whole thing of, like, the Chosen One.
Bringing balance to the Force, you know, the prophecy.
There's a supposed prophecy,
right.
And then, you know... And
but it was always
Dave Filoni and the shows kind of
yeah.
touch on it, but the films, because that's what a lot of people after this are like, what the heck? I thought, you know, at the end, the seventh one, I thought that was bringing balance to the Force. I thought that happened. I thought the prophecy was fulfilled.
Yeah.
You know, and what does that even mean? Because everyone's always like, how is it balance if you're just getting rid of one side? Balance
mm-hmm.
doesn't balance
right.
usually mean...
Yeah, one
both
side's
evil.
More heavier than the other.
So,
but then
I
we also
hope they touch on stuff like
that. Right, but we also have one of the interesting elements that I believe we've all heard the comments made by Sam Witwer about the character in The Force Awakens. When we first get that movie, it was Lor San Tekka who's talking to Poe Dameron
mm-hmm.
about saying that with no Jedi, there can be no balance of the Force. And what Sam Witwer was saying is, because of the fact that the Sith act from a place of imbalance, you need more Jedi by definition to kind of bring balance to that. That's one interpretation of it. I think in this movie...
That's an interpretation, though.
It is.
And he's not in that...
But
Star
you yourself
Wars,
call
right?
it a good explanation.
It's a good explanation, but this film might blow it to shreds.
It could, because of what happened. I mean, one of the interesting things here is, and why I feel that this does look like and feel like and sound like a different Star Wars film, is all encapsulated in this one thing, Jedi. Rian Johnson confirmed that the Jedi in Last Jedi is singular, referring to Luke, as what I had previously thought of. And if that is the case...
Like he's training her not to be a Jedi?
Or something, I don't know. I mean, you can still be trained and I guess something, but not necessarily a Jedi.
Well, one of the great things about leading up to The Force Awakens was that, like, that feeling of, like, I have no idea what
right.
that's going to be in this film,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because even with the trailers, they really gave nothing. You knew who was in there.
Right.
You don't even know their full names. And you're like, just to be able to watch a Star Wars film, not know anything... And then just, you know, see what happens. At the end of the day, though, halfway through the film, you could pretty much see where everything was going.
Right.
I just sort of want that Star Wars experience where you go in not knowing and, you know, up until those credits rolls, you know, you're just having a completely original experience.
The way I took it is that... there was a shot in the trailer where you get kind of the opposite shot of what you got in Force Awakens, remember when Luke put his hand on top of R2-D2, remember that?
Oh, like it was
when Rey had that flashback, so to speak, with the Force.
It was a vision.
Yes, and she saw what went down. We never saw exactly what was happening around Luke, and then we get that.
Mm-hmm.
We get that in this trailer because he's seeing the supposed Jedi temple
right.
that he built.
Right.
And
you see him dropping to his knees. And...
Yeah, and so he kind of feels like the name Jedi is kind of a bad omen, so to speak. So
we don't know what he feels about it yet.
Well, One of the
we can infer.
We can infer a lot about what we know so far, but what your concern is. I agree with you, though, that when he says, I know one thing the Jedi need to end, is definitely from the first act of the film. There is no
yeah.
question that that's what it's going to be.
Because you can see he says it from the cage.
Right. Maybe the first couple of moments of the film. We'll see about that. But as far as this moment when he says that, I don't think it's that far of a stretch to think that that's where he is. Especially as the trailer shows you, and what we know he's been through, is he was not necessarily the chosen one. But he was starting a new generation of Jedi. And he was doing that, and then it all went to shit when Kylo Ren killed everybody and literally burned all of it to the ground.
Yeah.
Think about what that does to you. How I mean, imagine what Obi-Wan felt like when Anakin took the dark side. It was just one student, but imagine that.
Because he had the high ground.
Imagine the entire order collapsing around you, and it's your fault. It was your failure as a teacher to get this from happening. It is your fault the Jedi are dying off, and you become so disillusioned with the whole thing that maybe you just think to yourself, it's just best that they go away, because if I can't do it, nobody can do it.
But here's the thing.
See?
I remember you expressed this concern a couple of days ago. When they did show the trailer, you're like, I hope that this isn't just the first act, and that throughout the whole entire movie, Rey changes Luke's mind.
Yeah.
So that would diminish.
That's probably gonna happen though, but not fully. I think probably what will happen is Luke will be convinced to train her, but not necessarily as a Jedi. You can't really change his ideology or philosophy just like that. I think it'll be an arc that we'll see through episode 9, if anything. It won't be a major, major change in what Luke's mentality is, but there will be a bond that will be forming with Rey. And by the way, she looks like she's going through the burner in this trailer. I mean,
yeah, she's like, you want to be a Jedi? Think again.
I mean, just the way that it was structured, when it opens up the trailer, you think you're looking at stars, and then you're looking at a damn rock, and you see Rey's hand. I think what's really indicative is Rian Johnson's directorial style here. The scenery looks absolutely exquisite. And in a way that could actually rival Rogue One, which we all think is the best shot, the best looking Star Wars film. And I'm glad, because one of the things that was lacking with Force Awakens was what Rogue One had, is those that amazing scenery and those visuals.
And also another thing that we didn't get in The Force Awakens that we got in Rogue One, that we're getting again in The Last Jedi, is space battles.
Oh yeah, and this one glimpse of a space battle that we got, I'm already more interested in that than what we saw in Starkiller Base. And it's not to say as if that, I think, and it's really unfortunate though, that battle had to compete with what was going on with Rey and Kylo, and I'm sorry, and this even happened the first time I saw the movie and the last time I saw Force Awakens, I'm always so much more interested in what's happening with Rey and Kylo than what's happening with Poe and the Starfighters.
It's kind of the Phantom Menace, because everything else, aside from what was going on with Maul, Qui-Gon, and Obi-Wan, was boring.
Mm-hmm.
But then the lightsaber fight was happening, and you're like, "This
that
I'd whole rather...
movie was shit."
That's true. So, I mean, we can't really go there. One of the things that Peter said brilliantly in the audio commentary for Rogue One...
The whole movie is shit. Oh, no.
No. Okay. See, that's why you should let me finish talking. Rogue One had one of the best space battles, and it will be near it impossible to top that. So,
it's
I hope...
To talk about, because like I said, about just more creativity in these Star Wars films, Rogue One really threw everything at the burner in that last battle, as far as everything we know, you know, as they have. And from the shot that you see in this film, you see there's going to be another battle with AT-ATs.
A ground assault,
same thing. And I guess my thing is, I really, they need to... I want more creative set pieces.
I think we're getting that, though.
We don't know. We've seen AT-AT battles.
I think you're focusing way too much on the things that you already know. There's plenty of new things in this trailer.
What set pieces? What new?
Talking about the spaceships and the new ships and the...
What was different?
The new
ship battle. How was
the
ship battle different?
I'm talking about the new iterations, the new designs.
But how was the ship battles different?
It's a ship battle.
Exactly, that's my point. But remember in Empire Strikes Back, how they had developed AT-ATs, and it created a new interesting set piece, ground assault, the way that they had
right.
to go around it to bring it down.
You're saying it looks the same to you?
I'm saying just more creativities in the set pieces they create, and that could lead to, you know, a lot of different things. I liked how in Rogue One, how to take out the shield or whatever, they used, what was it called, like a Warhammer or something?
The Hammerhead Corvette.
Yeah, they crashed it into that. Stuff like that. And, like I said, with the fifth one, they had the walkers and stuff like that. And that's why I'm kind of hoping they move past the whole thing of, like, this is an X-Wing, but a little bit different.
Yeah.
You know, this is an AT-AT, but a little bit different.
Or a TIE Fighter.
Yeah, or this is a TIE Fighter, but a little bit different. Like, just give me something completely brand new. And brand new in the way that it...
But we saw new designs for ships.
One of the ships isn't really that new, because we didn't see it, but it was described in one of the Aftermath books.
That's still new for the films, anyway. And Aftermath is after the original trilogy, so quite a while away.
Though I'm not attacking. I kind of feel like you're already defending the film, like I'm attacking.
I'm just defending what I saw in the trailer, and I think I saw more than what I saw in The Force Awakens, which was
More, but is it enough? That's my fears. That's why it's not even a criticism yet. Because I don't know. Like, really, I'm going to attack a film after seeing, like, two and a half minutes of it?
The Beast?
I saw the whole film.
You are already attacking it before the...
Because it shouldn't exist, it's shit.
Right.
You want to go there?
No, you can actually listen to it in our previous podcast.
Yes, I tore that piece of shit to shreds.
You and I don't agree at all on the Force Awakens music.
Oh, yeah.
But love the one that we saw on this trip.
Dude,
I really liked it.
The composition was gorgeous, what they did with it.
I loved it. Maybe it's Ryan Johnson. Because we all know JJ likes to He doesn't like I said with the whole box, he doesn't like getting out of that box.
You're saying that Ryan had more
maybe he
work
pushed
with Williams.
Williams to get do
a different sound.
More different sounds.
Yeah, I mean, the way that the trailer ended was a combination of the Star Wars theme and then with a lot of horror element to it.
Because I loved it. That was great.
Because
it also, after the shock of saying the Jedi must end.
Right. And
that was
great.
Perfect way to
do it.
Yeah.
It worked well.
Because the thing to note here is that all the main big trailers that you get are composed by John Williams himself, and he actually does the music for the trailers.
Right.
So that's another thing of note. Like, is that going to be the vibe that we're going to get throughout the entire duration of the film?
I mean, that tone and that vibe you got from the music was consistent throughout the entire trailer.
And just to go back a little bit, talking about interesting set pieces, another example of that would be Episode 6 with the whole Jabba. The assault on Jabba's castle.
Oh, okay. Right.
You know, and then they had to fight on the thing, and mm-hmm. then the sand.
The Sarlacc pit.
That was names. what was the giant?
The Rancor?
The Rancor, yeah.
What the fuck is this supposed to mean? It's just like,
he did that. And
but for the listening audience,
okay.
Peter is like waving his hands up and down like,
you're
what?
Making fun of me,
how?
But it helped you remember what it was.
Well,
so who's... Yeah.
Skua Sky Squad,
yeah.
But my point is, those are interesting, different things.
Right.
Yeah. And to your point with the music, yeah, I thought it was really great. And as far as the music, I haven't been really that impressed with
either of the
the new Star Wars films. And to be fair to the Rogue One, they had like
4 or 5
2 days.
Yeah,
to do it. But still, you know that's something that should be given a lot of
attention to because this is built on a franchise that had
possibly
one of the best scores of the entire history.
Not only that, AFI did list that the Star Wars soundtrack is the best score.
But you know what?
Yeah,
really,
but who are they?
Yeah. Okay.
American Film Institute.
One of the things about what makes this film so compounding as far as like predicting where it's going to go is this has a lot of ground to cover. It almost has too much ground to cover because
we got a lot more questions than we got answered in The Force Awakens.
Well, yeah, that's a big problem. I'm not even sure if that was intentional or if it was to its detriment about what happened there, but we practically had the bare minimum told to us about the state of the galaxy, the Republic, the Resistance, the First Order. How did that all happen? I mean, it was just all books that
and
we
also
all
that's
information
a huge,
from.
That's also
what
another huge...
to Jar Jar?
Exactly.
How did C-3PO get his red arm?
Yeah. Or how did Captain Phasma get out of the trash compactor?
According to Liam Neeson, they're already filming a spin-off movie about Jar Jar and how he...
Right, they're on set.
We in fact turn to the dark side, but no. Another thing that's huge is the fact that the Republic has fallen.
Mm-hmm.
Now the First Order has full reign to do whatever it wants.
Pretty much, because
it's like a civil war.
You destroy the capital,
yeah,
and the leadership, and it's like all these star systems are going to be like fleeing and going off on their own. That's the perfect environment for the First Order to swoop in and take over. Then, of course, you have the Resistance, which, from what we inferred in The Force Awakens, they're severely understaffed.
Because
they
should commission a clone army.
I agree.
Fight for them.
I agree.
What could go wrong?
dun, 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 dun.
Yeah, I don't know. That's all I got.
Yeah.
It's a short trailer.
But
it is intriguing.
But there are a lot of stuff at play. There's so much.
There's a lot of questions.
Also, let's look to the future a little bit into the future for a bit. Kathleen Kennedy did confirm that Carrie Fisher will no longer appear in episode 9.
I wonder why.
Really?
Okay. I told you this.
Right.
Remember when you were crying about I need to say the same. She's gonna be in episode 9. Duh, duh, duh.
Right.
I said a very good, probably the biggest thing that's probably going to happen with this
mm-hmm.
is that she probably won't even be in 9,
right.
And they're going to change episode 8
mm.
to end her story there. Which, I guarantee you, that's exactly what they did.
We have conflicting reports about what's happening, because a couple weeks back...
Who are you going to believe in this situation, though? Kathleen Kennedy, the head of Lucasfilm?
Right.
Or her
boss, Bob Iger. Bob Iger said the things about Carrie's scenes in Episode 8, her overall arc in that movie wasn't going to be affected, right? If we're going to go on his thing. And then Kathleen Kennedy said that Carrie Fisher won't be General Leia in Episode 9. She didn't say Leia wouldn't be in Episode 9 directly. As far as all I heard her say is Carrie Fisher will not be. But from what I understand is...
That's what I said, man.
Her character was written out of the Episode 9, so she won't be in that for sure. What you're saying is could actually happen. But what could also be a possibility is Episode 8 happens, it's not a conclusion, and she gets written off in Episode 9.
Well, yeah. But wouldn't that make you even angrier, though?
Well, wouldn't it you?
Well, yeah, but...
That's, yeah.
But it's much worse.
I prefer Episode 8 kind of closing the character.
I'd rather they rewrite it so that
right.
they close it there instead of just doing what they were doing. And then
it's
in the crawl...
hard when her scenes are already filmed.
The crawl for Episode 9. Leia's dead. Anyway. Moving on. Luke and Ray are battling. No.
Leia's dead.
Leia's dead. Anyways. Yeah, like, I don't want that.
I don't want that either, but I kind of fear that's what it's going to be.
That would be stupid. I'd rather they just rewrite it for 8, close her off, whatever they're going to do.
I just want to be clear. I've moved on from that. I'm quite content with what they have, and I believe in Kathy and the company. Every decision they've made has been more than respectful to Carrie Fisher. Aside from that one reservation about finding out in the text, oh, she died in an explosion. That would be pretty sad.
Mm-hmm. They wouldn't do that.
They would not do that, though. So, whatever it is, I'm sure they'll do the best they possibly can with what they have, keeping in mind that, yes, they can rewrite certain things, but the film was already done. Filming, anyway. Shooting was done, and they have Carrie Fisher scenes.
Yeah, but when they were done filming, they filmed for hours and hours and hours. They have extra footage. They can piece together an ending.
Something. Right.
They can piece together something. They have more than enough. Directors have worked with less, and then after an actor dies, they've been able to piece together
right.
it, make it work, and they'll be able to do something.
Because, like, I remember when they were in 2008, when The Dark Knight came out, I remember that Nolan came out and said that Heath Ledger had at least 6 more scenes to shoot. After,
really?
In the Dark Knight.
That movie was already like 3.5 hours. What else were they going to shoot?
6 more scenes?
6 more scenes after
that. No, that's stupid. That's ridiculous.
So, if they manage to do that with Heath Ledger and like kind of close off that character, there are more than...
Did they close off that character? It was just kind of left hanging and that was it.
Well, and then you can talk about The Dark Knight Rises and
That'll open up a whole new different
game. Yeah, that'll open up a different stuff.
The point is,
I think it worked for just that film.
Right.
I never questioned, like...
The series as a whole, though, that...
That screwed up the whole series, but...
Oh, well.
Oh, well.
Do you think we will get a reunion with Luke and Leia ever again? I think that's not going to happen. That was not planned for this movie. A scene with Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher.
That wasn't going to happen?
I'm asking you, we don't know. Do you think that scene was filmed between those two in Episode 8?
Yes. I think there was.
I really want that.
I think there was even a behind the scenes.
There was
photo.
It was a photo of those two.
That doesn't
mean that they were filming the same scene.
Well, I mean, if they're there on the same day at the same time.
It's probable.
Yeah.
I think
highly
it's more
probable.
Likely than not, yes, there is.
Yeah.
Okay. If there's not, that's kind of sad, because that would mean none of the original.
Three ever.
It's like. Yeah, that would make it really sad. That's what I was like going back to. But everything together, we haven't even seen anything about Laura Dern or Benicio del Toro having Snoke or Kylo, and Kylo thing is only full blown.
See,
like,
but for a lot of those, I don't think you should get too hyped.
Right.
Because remember,
they'll be secondary characters.
What's his name? The one who's like, look how old you become in the Force Awakens.
Max von Sydow.
Yeah, Max von Sydow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Remember, everyone's like,
he had a glorified
He was there for like 5 seconds. He wasn't nothing.
Right.
And so that's why with Benicio del Toro and a lot of these other side ones, I'm not gonna speculate or get too excited, because at the end of the day, it could be.
Well, I'm just going based off reports and what we're hearing. Other reports are saying that Billy Lord is going to have a bit of a bigger role in this film. Maybe more scenes with Carrie Fisher as Leia.
And then we were also introduced on the
Rose, a new character.
Yeah.
Who apparently they went out of their way to introduce that character.
She's a girl.
Which, apparently she's going to be paired up with Finn a lot in this film. Which I'm not sure what that is supposed to mean, but they also confirmed more Finn and Poe.
She's trying to take Rey's man. How dare she?
Is she kind of friend zoned?
Yeah, she's friend zoned. It kind of seems like there's going to be like three different stories going on.
Right.
So it'll probably be like
war, politics, religion.
Rey and Luke. Then it's going to be Finn and what's her name?
Rose and
Rose. I think it's just going to be those two, Finn and Rose. And I think Poe is going to be with... BB-8's going to be his guy. And they're going to be on their own thing.
Right.
Probably with, what's her name? Leia.
The Resistance.
Yeah. So I think it's going to be three different things.
What about Kylo and Snoke?
Four, I guess.
It's like,
there's a lot of storyline. There's a lot going to go on in the last Jedi.
They can intertwine and then combine.
Right.
Yeah.
But at certain points, I think there's going to be like...
With the amount of characters and the amount of cast and all of the circumstances surrounding it, this could be the most ambitious Star Wars film considering what we have so far. Especially even if they deliver on what you're saying about the end of the Jedi.
Yeah, but then remember how many... They were like, oh my god, there's so much they need to answer in The Force Awakens. And then The Force Awakens came and it's like, and they didn't answer shit.
They actually gave me more questions.
They just gave
you
more questions.
But you
questions.
Know what's really scary about that, though, is...
Yeah.
It all relies on Episode 9.
And Colin Trevorrow, if all they do is set up questions for Episode 9, we're really going to put our faith in Colin Trevorrow to answer them?
No. Yeah, so it's... I don't know. We still got a lot of time before 8 comes out.
I mean, in general, what has Colin done besides Jurassic World? That was a nice movie, but I mean, nothing about that was like, okay, you're ready for Star Wars.
He did, Batteries Not Included? Not Batteries Not Included.
Instructions Not Included?
Instructions Not Included.
Julio's favorite movie.
No, not that one.
No?
It's this film about how a guy's, he puts a help wanted ad. About how, I'm a time traveler. And is it Help Wanted? Or... It's something like that. And it's more like it's a smaller film. Not that effects-driven.
Right.
It's more... And, like, a reporter goes and does a story on him. It's a nice film. I'll put it that way. But, they just hired him because Jurassic World broke $1 billion.
Because the way I'm seeing it, I'm sensing, like, a pattern, like... The directors that they're getting kind of reflects what
No. I already know what you're gonna say.
What the original trilogy directors did.
You gotta get started on that.
J.J. Abrams is kind of the
Yeah, it's George Lucas.
George Lucas.
Version of Richard Mark one.
Yeah.
It's the same thing pretty much. And
yeah,
like,
but you should strive to be better.
Right, right. I mean, I don't think that was their intention, but it's like maybe fate is just putting out that way. I did want to say, to wrap this up, in general, the trailer did give a lot more story points than the Force Awakens teaser back in Celebration 2015. Then again, different circumstances.
You kind of needed to.
But to be fair, we had no idea who the hell those people were.
Right.
That one, this one, we know who they are. So.
Right.
It's different.
And the other thing, the Lieutenant moments. I guess that's it.
But what about the Rebels, though?
No. The poster. The teaser poster. How do we think about that one?
Go poster.
I'm going to get it when it comes into circulation.
I loved it.
It's very red.
Very red.
They use a lot of red ink.
And
blue
white.
And white. Blue and white. Red,
blue.
Red, white, and blue.
American colors.
Yes.
God bless America.
God bless Iron Man 2. Iron Man 2 reference, guys.
Don't know. Keep your references to the main... Mainstream.
Star Wars Rebels.
Star Wars Rebels. Okay, according to Dave Filoni, we are confirmed that season 4 will be the final season.
Good riddance.
Okay, why good riddance, Peter? Why good riddance? I want to know what. Why are you so bitter towards this?
He's just being antagonistic to get under my skin. He loves to do that.
Bingo.
He doesn't actually mean that, because he has been on several shows praising the hell out of the show.
What?
In certain episodes here. Rebels in House Kitchen? I think it was
Provide the evidence, sir.
I mean, I'll look it up right now, and we can get to your previous statements.
Yeah, I like the show. Yeah, it's good that it's ending, just so it doesn't go on too long. Especially because they don't have that long of a time frame.
Yeah.
So, I don't see an issue with it.
This show had a shelf life from the very beginning, because it was close to A New Hope.
Then again, so did Clone Wars, and I would seem like they wanted to go for like 8 seasons.
At the very least. Depending on what that happened.
And then also on that panel, we got the trailer.
Yeah. We got a lot of different things about...
apparently, there's like a pet wolf that they have.
Well, Dave Filoni he loves wolves in general. And I remember back when he was trying to incorporate them in an arc with Ahsoka, I think toward the end of the series. He was always trying to put wolves in whenever he was possible. I don't know what exactly they'll mean here, but we got the trailer for the season 4 of Rebels, and it looked very different than what we've gotten in the past.
I mean, we've got, so far, Saw Gerrera is coming back.
Right, we confirmed.
Bo-Katan.
Right, Bo-Katan, which, I think there was a quick shot of her holding the Darksaber. So maybe she... She was holding the Darksaber.
Really?
Right, which means, remember back that Sabine was saying that she was going to find somebody to liberate Mandalore. Bo-Katan is that person. Remember way back when that she was there when Maul took...
Nerds.
Mandalorian from...
Thank you.
the Mandalorians. And that whole thing. But yeah, I thought it was a good trailer. A lot of interesting stuff, and that'll happen in the fall, I think.
I don't think it was, I don't think it was, like, as epic.
Well, they didn't show that much.
Yeah.
That's why they purposely showed nothing. Almost next to nothing. They show a couple things here and there. But, I mean, they just had their finale, 2 weeks ago? They're not going to come back until October. How much are they really going to show you at this point?
The whole season.
Although they did have the season 4 premiere ready, and apparently it was screened there for select critics, and it's getting some jaw-dropping reaction from it. The thing about season 4 is, and this comes directly from Dave Filoni, the producer of the show, saying that this season will be the most radically different in structure and in tone than anything they've done before on this show and in Clone Wars, the way that he was phrasing it. It's going to be darker, it's going to be more serialized, in the sense that...
It's going to be darker and more intense.
Right. The way that I get is that when you get back into season 4, we're going to deal directly with the Mandalorian stuff, and then once that's wrapped up, the rest of the season will be one continuous long arc. And every episode will... Imagine like Game of Thrones or Walking Dead. It just builds and builds and builds to a finale. And a lot of interesting stuff that we're getting here, and I think this was intentional, because you know how he is during that panel, he had an Ahsoka Lives shirt with a question mark. After the trailer was over, he came back with a different shirt, Ahsoka Lives, with an exclamation point. Filoni and Pablo Hidalgo were teasing back in Thursday that there was some Ahsoka stuff in season 4. I know that we had a podcast a couple weeks ago that you said that Ahsoka would come back for the series finale. Do you think that'll pan out?
Yeah.
Is it pretty obvious at this point that that's going to happen?
Oh, God, yes.
And if that were to happen...
She's going to get stabbed.
What the hell is the outcome? We got one more season. What's going to happen? I mean, yes, I know what you're going to say, and yes, I agree with you there. But how is it going to play out with Kanan, Ezra, and Ahsoka left on the chessboard?
Darth Vader's going to come in and just stab them all in the face. Dun 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 dun. And that's it. Well, okay. Because, how come you guys didn't ask how I felt about the trailer?
He's the host.
What's up?
How did you feel about the trailer?
They had lightsabers and spaceships.
And that is why I didn't ask.
But anyways, this is what's going to happen. Ezra needs to die. Kanan needs to die. Who's that? Who's the monkey-looking dude? He needs to die too, just because.
Bastain?
Zeb.
Why Zeb? Why not?
My God, you're more hostile than George R. R. Martin.
Point is, they need to die because they are Jedi and they are not.
Zeb isn't a Jedi.
I know, but it's just like, why not?
Oh my god, they are
not supposed to be Jedi by the time Episode 4 rolls around, and none of this technicality bullshit. And we're like, oh, they left the Jedi Order, so you know. No, they need to be dead. They cannot be around. Hera obviously is still alive, and so is Chopper.
Wait a minute, I thought you said that the ghost blew up in the Battle of Scarif.
What do you mean?
You have evidence. What Peter's referring to is because they announced this new series,
Forces of Destiny, right?
Which is
Forces of Girl.
These animated shorts that are canon that will focus on Leia, Jyn Erso, Rey, Ahsoka, Sabine, and Hera.
And then there's this one prominent short that's going to feature Leia and Harrison Dula
teaming up with Han Solo on the Battle of Endor Episode 6.
With Ewoks battling the good fight. Isn't that great, Peter?
In addition to also confirming Captain Rex on the Battle of Endor.
Yes. It's the thing we know.
I'm not going to get into that again. I never got into that. Yeah, I just think, whatever. That's my whole thought process to that.
I think they're upset that not everybody is dying off in the show.
They need to. That's
even
the point.
Hera?
No, Hera, she's fine. And by the way, she does the voiceover in the trailer. It's really starting to make it sound like she's going to be the only one left.
Yeah.
Even, what's it called? That teenager.
Sabine?
Yeah. Who obviously listens to Fall Out Boy and Nirvana and gets mad at her parents because she wears colored hair. I'm just being dumb.
Okay.
Yeah, I think they made it seem like everyone except for her
Chopper
and Hera and Chopper live.
You mean Sabine even included that Chopper?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Included, she may even die as well.
Right.
But we don't know.
So we're gonna get the Rogue One ending.
As long as the two Force weirdos die, they need to just. And I'm saying that not because I enjoy death or I want them to die. It's because, for continuity's sake, I just think it'll be a complete bullshit and a huge cop-out if they're still around when,
What about Admiral Thrawn?
He can survive, because his whole story, when he was originally created, was that after the Empire fell...
After the Emperor fell,
he was still around and doing shit, so it would make sense if he still survived.
Right. I really hope he survives at the end of the series. I want to see more of him.
I think he should. I think he definitely...
One other thing for me is, look, as far as...
Thrawn is Snoke.
It's Ahsoka.
As far as the show...
Oh, that's right.
...is concerned, I think it makes sense that this is the last season. I was probably thinking that maybe this or maybe even season 5 would be the last thing.
Every new season would have annoyed me. Just because
it's
like,
already annoying you.
You're getting too close.
Clone Wars was like 6 seasons and it's like a 3-year time span.
Yeah, but the difference was they followed a lot of different characters.
That's true.
So like half of the characters, it could be going on at the same time as this thing, and you know, it made sense. You could go longer because you could follow like 10 or 20 different characters.
But I think the key distinction is here, it's not as if Disney said, okay, this is your last show. This was Dave Filoni's decision.
Yeah.
And that must have been hard because this is his baby.
All of this is.
Didn't he get a promotion?
Yeah, he's overseeing all Star Wars animation.
That's probably why, too.
So he's like, there are other things he wants to get on the burner, too. But I think it's substantial that this is the showrunner's decision to draw the show to a close.
Yeah.
And I think we should probably touch on the fact that they're doing something dramatically different this season. With the fact that it's pretty much going to be one long arc. He said himself that people would call this the darkest season that they've ever made. Does that pretty much just kind of go into what you said about
hopefully
death? And look at the smile he has talking about death.
Oh,
but okay, just a couple more things.
Yes.
Genevieve O'Reilly back as Mon Mothma, and we're going to see the rift between her and Saw Gerrera.
And see what happened before Rogue One happened.
Right.
See, that's kind of cool.
Because that's important. To kind of,
I don't know if it's important.
Well,
but
to
it's,
where
it's
we
just,
are at Rogue One.
It's cool to see. If you're exploring shit in a television series, that's something cool to see. Because you know there's some stuff that you're like, oh, it's, we need to see this explored. And I'm like,
yeah, sometimes, yeah.
That's bullshit.
Yeah.
You don't need to see that explored. But there's other shit
to,
where it's like, that's cool.
Right.
All the technicalities, right, Peter?
Yeah.
But in general, I mean, I found myself...
The boogaloo.
I found myself feeling nothing but pride when that was announced. Because one of the things that quite... And thank you for laughing. I always appreciate it. One of the things that was quite moving, and, you know, Dave Filoni is somebody who never, ever, like, gets emotional. But there was something different when he was getting to the point where he was, like, thanking everybody on the show, and then he was going to make the announcement. And I could have sworn I saw him getting misty-eyed or something. Like, he sounded very, very just, like, sentimental about the whole thing, that it was his decision to end it. And when he said, look, I know what it feels like to not being able to end a show before, that's not going to happen again.
I think you were just getting misty-eyed.
No, actually, you saw the video right there, but, no.
Were you getting misty-eyed?
Right now?
Have you?
No, when you...
Not yet, but it's,
Not yet. We're guaranteed.
Well, not yet. I mean, okay, I'm going to be attacked for getting misty-eyed. When you cry every 5 seconds, anybody says hope and has, buns...
I usually don't give a shit about anything, so I'm good.
Wonderful.
Wait, no. What's a film I cried at? I don't know.
No, but the thing, why this is important...
Probably something extraordinarily happy.
Like what?
I don't know.
What's a happy film?
There's not very much of them.
Yeah,
nowadays.
Right? You see?
One of the things that I want to say...
Yes.
Before we go on to the next thing is, when I said that, I felt nothing but pride about this.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and I know that you were in agreement on this as well, what Dave Filoni has been able to do in Clone Wars and also in this show is provide worthwhile Star Wars content that only just adds fuel to that passionate fire that you have for all things Star Wars. And I know for a fact I wouldn't be as into this if it not for him and for the work that he provided. So I just want to thank him personally for what he's done. I think he's somebody who deserves that. And you know what? If this is ending as it is planned, could there propel the rumors that he could be directing a standalone film in the very near future?
Hopefully, I'd watch it.
I think what he's been doing to it, I mean... First and foremost, the thing to take from Dave Filoni is that he's a fan.
Right.
He's a huge fan of everything that's going on, and he is the apprentice of George Lucas himself.
He's a fan, but he knows how to restrain himself.
And then, if anybody to, you know, tap into these different stories, who other than a fan...
Right.
To tap into these stories, because like you said, Peter, and I understand where you're coming from. The whole getting too close to comfort to the original trilogy and going into something that shouldn't be unaltered.
Right.
Little jab for you guys out there. So I understand where you're coming from, Peter. But again, the thing I take from Dave Filoni is that he is a fan who respects this whole entire series and saga, you know. And yes, there are those technicalities, like the twins.
He respects it, but then he really pushes the boundaries a lot. Like, where he says things like, well, technically.
Not to the point where he said he fucks with it. That's a different thing altogether. I think he does push those boundaries, but I think, for me anyway, they definitely work. And
yeah,
I gotta say, though. If you're a Star Wars fan, and if you haven't seen Clone Wars or Rebels, you are missing out. You definitely are. So, Dave Filoni did these shows. He worked under George Lucas. Both of us love these shows, or like, whatever. I don't know what he's doing. But go and watch them. I mean, and you know what's really interesting about this upcoming season? This could be his best work yet. This season 4. They're putting all all of the resources into it.
Could be. But you know what could be the best yet? Star Wars Land. Star Wars.
Oh, did they announce something for that?
Yeah.
What did they announce?
Well, Alexis.
Well, today they had a panel about Imagineering and Lucasfilm teaming up. They're pretty much the masterminds that crafted the entire design for the land, as well as the story and where this exists in the Star Wars universe and everything. They went into details about how this land will be the most immersive themed land ever. They were even going into extreme detail about how the shops would look. They were even saying how when you go to the bathroom, you may want to watch out for the water. They're going to put in these
What are they going to do?
Well, you know how in Harry Potter land they have that thing with Myrtle, right?
Yeah.
In the bathrooms?
You hear her voice in the bathrooms.
Oh, that's cool.
So,
I need to go to Harry Potter Land. Don't they have it in
California?
In Hollywood, yeah.
This summer, maybe.
Also, Peter, you're gonna get this.
Okay.
Get this.
You know how I usually don't give a shit about, like...
No.
This kind of stuff, so you need to wow me right now.
Okay. This theme park, this addition to the theme park...
Yes.
Is canon within the Star Wars timeline.
And you know why?
I don't give a shit.
The head of the Lucasfilm Story Group, Pablo Hidalgo, is working very hands-on with engineering on
this. Hold on, though. What the hell does it mean, canon?
It exists within the Star Wars universe. This place with the land.
Is my Slurpee cup canon if I buy it?
Yeah. When you take a shit in the freaking bathroom.
That shit is canon.
Right.
That's the important thing to take from this.
What does it mean, canon? Like, I kind of don't understand what that means.
Because, like, Pablo Hidalgo,
I understand it's, like, movie accurate. But what the hell does canon?
The head story writer basically said that they're working extensively on making a whole entire story out of the whole entire theme park.
To put it in layman's terms, this is basically like Tortuga or Radiator Springs version of Star Wars.
I totally get that. And making it film accurate.
Right.
But... how is that canon?
It takes place... Okay, look. As far as the Star Wars land in particular that you will visit...
Yes.
That will take place in the timeline of the new films, right?
Yes.
But as far as being in the canon, is that this place in Star Wars land... It also exists in the actual film universe.
Okay, so...
It's been around for thousands of years.
It's an original area that we haven't seen in the films yet.
Ever.
Right. But it's actually there.
Yeah, it's been there for thousands of years.
Okay.
It's like a smuggler's place, like Tortuga.
Oh, okay. So it's like working backwards.
Yeah.
Also, the thing that I found interesting was that there's going to be a Millennium Falcon ride. And you're going to, individual people get to pilot the Millennium Falcon. Either you do well or fail, if you fail at it, the characters
kick out of the park.
that
would be pretty funny though.
The characters around the area in the theme park will treat you as such. They'll know if you failed at piloting the Falcon, and they'll treat you. Yeah.
So here's what he's talking about. The Millennium Falcon attraction. Riders will have the ability to control the iconic smuggling vessel, and if riders mess that up, their failure could affect the way that they are treated by the characters in that land, because one of those things that Star Wars Land will feature is the people who work there will actually be trained as like residents of them. So like there will be actual characters in that land.
Will one of the workers come and knock my cannon Slurpee out of my hand for failing the ride?
It's not that descriptive. But.
I guess the thing is, and I'm sure it's gonna be really immersive, and it seems like they're getting pretty ambitious for what they're doing. But people always have to remember this. No matter how immersive and how great they make the land around it, it always does take you out of it when there's like 50 or 100 people around you that aren't dressed in Star Wars because they're visitors as well. Yeah, your family's with the fanny packs and their strollers walking around. Like, that does take you out of feeling of Star Wars. Because, like, in the concept art, you always see people saying, like, oh, it's amazing, this concept art. And I'm like, yeah, but just imagine that with, like, 50 right. other regular people, or 500
I mean, you know, not just for the details, I mean, this will be the largest expansion in the entire resort's history. It will be a 14-acre sized land, which is larger than Cars Land. And that's a pretty big, that's a pretty big plot of land right there.
And Cars Land is pretty cool.
And, in addition to all of this, information that we have here by Scott Trowbridge, who is the creative director of this, saying that the escape from the First Order ride would be the most epic adventure that the theme park has ever created.
Well,
they're throwing everything they have at this one ride. And we even saw pictures of AT-ATs that are being constructed.
Oh, I did. I think I saw a picture where they're doing going to do like full scale.
Yeah.
AT-AT. That would be if they give me a full scale AT-AT. That's amazing.
It's not just one; they're making multiple.
Because, and I'll say this: like for me, like Cars, I'm cool with Cars, but I really couldn't give a shit
about the movies
about Cars, like
right.
a Cars Land. When they told me, I'm like, who cares?
But when you went,
but once
there,
you get there, it's like, oh, that's from the movie. That's
right.
cool. Like that's really.
And
cool.
I love and I love the detail. Like
yeah.
I've told you this before that
the third blink
is slower.
I just love that detail.
I do, because it's like, they watch the movie, and it's the thing I know.
It's the thing I know from the thing. But, like, if I'm able to get excited about something from a movie where I'm just sort of like, I'm cool with, I'm lukewarm, but I'm not, like, in love with Star Wars, which I'm already in love with, like, it'll probably just, my brains will be splattered across the floor. They'll be blown, you know? My mind will be blown, that's what I'm trying to say.
Right.
Very descriptive.
Very descriptive, yes. So, it'll be cool, but I'll probably won't be able to see it till like, 7 years from now.
No, it's actually going to be opening in 2019. My expectation...
Yeah, the tickets, man.
Oh,
and
wow.
And the crowds.
Well, I mean...
It might be like 20 years before the crowds go.
I think that Star Wars Land will be open by the time the next Celebration happens, because we're not going to have Celebration next year.
How come?
It'll come back in 2019. They're taking a year off.
Okay.
So, that's all the stuff, which, I mean, I'm excited. It's almost here. I think we're almost there.
Are you going to be early adopter? Are you going to be there day one?
I think that is completely determinant about how my finances are. I don't have any money, so.
Not only.
But as far as showing up their opening day, no.
You know how much those tickets are going to cost?
They're going to rise them up as much as they can.
Humanly possible. And, I don't know. To me, that's a whole hassle thing. I already don't like leaving my room. So, I've been spending money at this time.
You know, you realize we're trying to organize a trip later this year, and you're like, I don't want to leave my room.
Anyway, so how are you feeling today, Kai? What do you think of the news in the world?
I am... Actually, because of all the Star Wars stuff going on, I'm actually very content about what all the content.
All of this sounds very ambitious.
Yeah.
The common theme: Last Jedi, Rebels season 4. This, they're really just going at it in all cylinders.
Too much good news. Let's talk about North Korea, guys.
You know what? Instead.
Yes,
instead of talking about what's going on now, let's go back to the past and talk about that 40th anniversary panel.
We're going back to the future.
Wade's World, man.
The 40th. Oh yeah, you guys go ahead, go teary eyed, cry about it.
Okay. The highlight of the whole entire panel, that Carrie Fisher tribute.
Yeah.
Was that or was that not stellar?
It was pretty stellar.
I think that was really stellar.
Now, you think about the actual video that was produced.
Yeah, the
right.
the whole.
It was tubular, dude.
It was, man. It was rather groovy.
I thought it was...
Hang 5.
Hang 10.
You're
5 digits off. But I think that it was definitely a great tribute to Carrie Fisher. It showed her being a bombastic and outlandish. And
They cut the best moments. It was edited wonderfully.
Yeah, and then also you had David Bowie's Rebel, which is always not that bad, you know. David Bowie, he's always good.
It also, it just captured the spirit of Carrie Fisher.
I would have been cool with them just showing the video of her
reciting the original line.
No. Of when she roasted George.
Oh my God!
When she spoke for him.
That was amazing.
Her entire speech was hilarious.
She was like, I hope I slept with you to get the job. Because if not,
who the hell was that guy? But that was just the final line. The entire speech was freaking hilarious. It's, if you guys haven't seen it, you should watch it. It's hilarious. And it just shows what a great writer she is.
Yeah, like she script doctored all the three movies that she was in, plus some the other ones that she worked on. She's like, this seems a little redundant. Let's change this. And then to put the cream of the crop on there, at the end you thought, okay, this is it. A curtain came down. And John Williams himself,
here come the waterworks,
seriously, came in and personally scored Leia's themes.
That's great.
Look, I have to say, that entire panel was outstanding from the moment.
Yeah.
The ovations that George Lucas got, even Hayden Christensen, I don't know, like a rock star.
Yeah.
Like announcement. Harrison Ford coming in. When was the last time we saw Harrison, Mark, and George in the same place along with Anthony, Peter, and
probably
Billy
since,
Williams?
Like, the 80s.
But since the last Jedi, they're all coming back for the new film, The Last Jedi. No, from the Return of the Jedi, probably.
And you know what? When that, I thought we were gonna end off with that tribute video.
Yeah.
And then the camera get going, and they're like, "What are they doing? What are they doing?" And the curtain.
She's back, guys.
Surprise!
I'll be honest. I would have loved it. You would have loved it.
What if she can? Well, yeah.
It was an elaborate joke.
That dude, you know what?
Star Wars Celebration, guys.
You know what? That wouldn't be too far off about what Carrie Fisher would do.
Oh, I think it would be very far off.
Some people would be really upset. But when the curtain was unveiled and then you saw who was there, I remember I was screaming, oh my god. That was perfect craftsmanship.
What was so cool was that Billie Lourd came in and she...
Her daughter.
Yeah, she did her little tribute to her, and she was like, three things my mom has taught me, and then she said, first, and she recited the entire, help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi, you're my only hope. She did that, and then, it was kind of nice that, you know, that she's like the full representative of Carrie Fisher. That was pretty cool. And then just them talking about, you know, the process of making it, Billy Dee Williams was there, and he was Billy Dee Williams.
I want my Billy Dee. Why isn't he in the new films?
He's
the coolest cat in the galaxy.
He is the coolest cat.
And I always say this, but whenever people are talking about, oh, Han Solo, he's so cool, and I'm like...
Put him in there.
No, Billy Dee's way cooler. He's got the cape. He's got the ladies,
he's got the
city in the sky, he's got the voice. He's got the stash.
Nothing like a good, cool,
he's got the stash.
Yeah, he was even asked, and he said, I'm not going to be in episode 8. What the hell?
Why? They need to ask him back. And I know I'm the one that's like, dude, you should. No. You need Billy back.
You need Lando, man.
You're
going to
get Lando
with
Han Solo.
No,
Donald Glover.
I do love Donald Glover, but still, you need the original.
Episode 9. It's not...
They better do it. I'm gonna be pissed if they don't.
And then later on, I think it was yesterday, Mark Hamill did his own little panel.
Wait, wasn't that for... did he do...
He did
was
a...
Was that part of the...
The 40th anniversary?
No, it wasn't. He did his own...
No, I'm saying, was it part of The Last Jedi? Or was it just a panel?
No, it was a separate panel all in itself. It was a Carrie Fisher tribute to... and he got emotional. He was like saying, this is something I wrote to Carrie, and he started to cry. And you know, the thing to take away from Mark Hamill is that he's always, you know, he's kind of like the Joker. He puts on a smile and he's like, he presents himself in this like wide, you know, kind of warmth way, you know. And then all of a sudden to see him break down and, you know, just shed.
I think he's always been real genuine. That's what I like about him.
But
right, I mean, he could probably keep it together. That's the thing.
That's what I mean.
Right.
I think he's always...
He had tears in his eyes the entire thing. You can tell. And his voice was, like, going and going. And he tried to plow through it. But that moment, when he's reading the statement...
Yeah.
He wrote a week after she had passed away, reading it to the audience there. That was devastating. And it really just shows you that, in general... they...
A general?
Maybe
she's royalty.
They had their own family unit so much as we had ours. And I think the entire weekend could be surmised as to why this franchise has lasted 40 years. It's a story about family.
Marketing,
yeah, and money. Story about family. And I think that simplicity...
Like, Fast and Furious.
I think that simplicity connects with as many people as possible. So, you know, I know that you yourself, the waterworks were... Especially that 40th anniversary panel.
I'm sorry. If a CG version of Leia for 5 seconds can get you bawling like a little girl, I do not even want to know what that panel did to you.
Wasn't he messaging us about crying in the car or something?
Yeah, he was. Well, yeah. Yeah.
Is that what happened?
That was early in the morning, too.
It was 8 a.m. What was happening?
Okay, what happened was is that, you know, after I got done with class, I went to... Everywhere else was full. Everybody was doing their thing in school. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to go in my car and watch the panel, you know?
Yeah.
And then, it's so, so poetic that as soon as I put on the panel, that tribute came on.
That was right when the video started?
Right when the video started, right when I got in, right when I turned on my laptop, right then and there, the whole Carrie Fisher thing came on, and I'm like this, the universe likes to mess with me. So I watched that, and you know, I was like,
it was just a video at this point.
Yeah, I'm not gonna cry in my car in the middle of my college campus parking lot. I'm not gonna do that.
You did it.
And then John Williams.
I'm like, damn you, why are you doing this to me? So I think it was a very bittersweet celebration because of the whole looming, because the topic of the entire celebration was Carrie Fisher, you know, that was the
primary
thing.
But I will say, though, her spirit was there.
Yeah.
Her presence was felt.
To quote Mark Hamill, her big brown eyes, her sly smile is extending around the stars, and out extended is a giant middle finger pointing straight at me.
This is depressing. Let's talk about happier things. So North Korea, guys.
No, we're not going to go there. Fortunately enough, uh-huh. That's all we have left to talk about.
That's it?
Yeah, that's it.
What about, I don't know. Yeah, that's it.
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us on Red Spotlight Entertainment. I'm your host, Kyle Lira, and today, Alexis Soto.
Thanks for
watching, listening.
Peter Martinez. Damn you. Anyway, check us out. Check us out on podcast.com. Listen to it there if
iTunes.
You have Android. iTunes for
MySpace.
Those with...
Friendster. Snapchat.
Tinder.
Oh, talk about May.
Tinder. Grindr.
Talk about May. It's a big
May. Month. May is going to be a very busy month. We have the first Star Wars audio commentary for May the 4th coming out. And then we also have all 4 Pirates of the Caribbean movies distributed to you by audio commentary.
Right.
And that's, of course, leading up to the fact that Pirates of the Caribbean Dead Man Tell No Tales is coming out.
In addition to Guardians Volume 2 happening,
yes.
Covenant is going to be a very, very busy month in May.
Very, very busy.
Oh, no, that's not until later.
Yeah, that's going to be in November.
Is it?
Justice League?
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wonder Woman's coming out in June.
Wonder Woman's coming out in
June. That's an awesome score.
So, yeah. Sounds great.
Yeah, and also check out all our After Darks on the channel. Please like and subscribe if you...
You don't have to.
That's only if you want to, though. Anyway, I'm Kyle Lira. This is Red Spotlight Entertainment. Tori and Kermit, take it away.
Chester, why are there so many songs about rainbows? And what's on the other side?
Rainbows are visions, but only illusions.
been told, and some choose to believe it, but I know they're wrong. Wait and see.
Yeah. Someday we'll find it.
Yeah.
The rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me.
Wow, I wish I could sing like you.
Who said that every wish would be heard and answered? Who wished on the morning star?
Well, you know, somebody just thought of that, and someone believed it. And look what it's done so far. You know?
What's so amazing that keeps us stargazing? What do we think we might see?
Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me, all of us under its spell. We know that it's probably magic.
Yeah. Have you been half asleep, and have you heard voices?
I've heard them calling my name. Mm-hmm.
Is this the sweet sound that calls the young?
The voice might be one and the same.
I've heard it too many times to ignore it. It's something that I'm supposed to be.
Yeah. Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers.